Real quick, I do want to acknowledge some of our sponsors. We can't do these things without sponsors. I totally want to hear you give it up for Shell, Rice, and KPMG. Hello, I heard you amen Jeff earlier, so I think you can do better than that. Let's give it up for Shell, KPMG, and Rice. Thank you, awesome. We also have main stage sponsors, my company, Experience Energy, SNB, Fueling Us Forward, GE Oil and Gas, Enbridge, formerly Spectra, Jive Software, Marathon Oil, Progressly, Upskill Houston, which is an initiative by the Houston Partnership, Workday, and Workforce Next. And last night we had a beautiful reception. It was packed. In fact, I think we almost ran out of wine in like the first 30 minutes of the event, which tells you how much fun we were having. So, and Challenger Great Christmas were very, very generous in sponsoring that, as well as Jen and Chris Homan. So at this time, we also have a number of speakers and sponsors across the world. We've got local sites dialed in from Denver. So Denver is joining us right now. So hey, Denver. Can you guys say, hey, Denver? Hey. I can't hear you. Hey. Awesome. So Denver and West Virginia. Can we say hello to West Virginia? Hey. All right. West Virginia, LSU Baton Rouge. Woo! All right. And last night, so it's the evening there, but last night we had colleagues meeting in Nairobi, Kenya. So we had an entire HERWorld event last night while I was sleeping, because I get lots of sleep, right? We talked about that earlier. Nairobi, Kenya was sponsoring their HERWorld location there in Africa. So really, really excited about that. And we do want to thank ABC and HBJ, as well as Alucast. So if you have a chance, I want you to stop by and check out the Alucast pink manhole covers. There's a story there, and we'll tell it later. I'm going to re-welcome back our MC, Miss Gina Gaston.
So we're going to get started with our second session, second panel, Taking the Lead, Women in Energy. Fewer than 20% of the top leaders across all sectors are women, with 4.2% in the C-suite, 18% in top positions, and only 19% in government. Little has changed for women in the past 20 years. So it is time to take the lead. Join this panel of gender parity experts and industry leaders to gain insights on how we can prepare, develop, inspire, and propel women to take their fair and equal share of leadership positions across all sectors by 2025. So our moderator for this panel is Kathy Steffek. Kathy has enjoyed a 20-year career guiding the growth of traditional, blended, and online programs at some of the country's most respected universities. As the Director of External Affairs for the Global Energy Management Program at the University of Colorado, Denver, Ms. Steffek is responsible for the cultivation of corporate and executive partnerships, as well as leading the strategic direction of the program's marketing and communication initiatives. Come on down. Kathy. Gloria Feldt. She is the co-founder and president of Take the Lead Women, the new women's leadership movement to prepare, develop, inspire, and propel women to take their share of leadership jobs, as we said, by 2025. People magazine calls her the voice of experience. Gloria's expertise in women, power, and leadership comes from a deep well of personal knowledge gained on the frontiers. Take the Lead Women is a proud partner to Pink Petro, offering an online leadership certificate course. Gloria, please come forward. Dr. Michelle Mikki Hebl. Did I say it correctly? Okay. That's fine. That's like almost correctly. Close, Gina. She's a professor of psychology and management here at Rice University. She joined the faculty at Rice in 1998, and as an applied psychologist whose research specifically focuses on workplace discrimination and the barriers stigmatized individuals, that is women and ethnic minorities, face in social interactions, the hiring process, business settings, and the medical community. An avid Green Bay Packer fan, she also completed her quest to run a marathon on each continent in 2016. You go, girl. Come on down. We have a lot of runners in the room, don't we? How many of you are runners? I'm just curious. Quite a good number. Okay. Maybe it has to do with the energy. Maybe there's a correlation. I don't know. Okay. Tandra Jackson, who you met earlier. She's the managing partner of the Houston office of KPMG LLC. She has over 23 years of professional experience across multiple industries, including energy and chemicals, industrial manufacturing, and healthcare. Tandra is a member of Louisiana State University's Dean Advisory Council and the Advisory Board of the National Association of Corporate Directors Houston Chapter. She is a member of KPMG's African American Network National Advisory Board. Please welcome her back. And Sandra Smith. She is the Director of Talent Management at Marathon Oil. She is a connector, achiever, practitioner, and above all else, believer in inserting needed and real transformational change into everyday life. Prior to Marathon Oil, Sarah was at Schlumberger for 18 years, driving innovation through various HR and talent management roles by embedding change in every step. And did we also mention she started as a geologist? A great story. Don't be afraid to ask about it. Please come forward, Sarah. So, Kathy, I'll turn it over to you.
Right. Thank you, Gina. I think if my husband's watching from work, yes, it's your worst nightmare. I have a microphone. Look out. And I'm bringing it home. So, Katie, just so you know. Well, thank you all for coming, and thank you to our expert group of panelists. I have to tell you, it's so exciting to see everyone here, to know that all of the host sites are watching. We have so many people around the world watching. We're very, very excited to be able to get on with this discussion. One of the reasons why we at the GEM program have been working with Katie for so many years now is because we share the same passion. We want to see the advancement of careers in the energy industry. We want to help promote the next generation of leaders. And we really want to make sure that women have a seat at that table. And that's what we're going to discuss today, is how we get there and how we get to those roles and how do we keep those roles and how do we help future generations get those seats. So thank you to our panelists. One of my roles as a moderator is to ask questions. But my first question is not going to be to the panel. It's going to be to the audience, to the audience worldwide, to our host sites. Do you have enough ink in your pen and enough paper? Because the amount of wisdom that's going to come out of this panel and the amount of tips and sage advice that you're going to get from this discussion, you may run out. So I just want to warn you, I really believe we're going to leave you with wanting more from this discussion. So thank you. So, Gloria, I'm going to start with you and ask you the first question from your years of experience. Women have more education than men. We're half the workforce. We hold the power of the purse, where we purchase 80% of consumer goods. And why is it that there's not that parity in leadership and in pay?
Simple question.
Yeah, simple question.
Let me make sure. Can you hear? Is this working? While we're figuring this out.
Great. Okay, so listen, I'm going to answer that question, but I want you all to do something here. Stand up for a moment and get yourselves in your power pose, okay?
All right.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Okay? You feel the power?
I'm ready.
All right.
Thank you very much. That is the answer to your question, in short. In short, the answer to the question is women have the power, and we have an ambivalent relationship about that very often. Mm-hmm. And I will tell you how I came to this conclusion. So in 2008, the time that it seemed like we were going to have our first woman president, if you're feeling a little deja vu about that comment, Elle magazine asked me to write an article about women running for office. And they assumed that because there was a woman at the top of the ticket, that women would be jumping all over themselves to throw their hats in the ring to run for office. What I quickly found was that the story was, in fact, women don't run. And you can't complain about not having parity in politics if you don't run. Can you win if you don't run? No. Can you get into the C-suite if you don't put your hand up and say, I want that job? No. So what I found was that there were theories about women having less ambition than men. And I quickly looked at all the research, and I interviewed women all over the country, and I came to the conclusion that that was absolutely false, mm-hmm. that women have plenty of ambition, but what we have less of is intentionality. Because of that ambivalent relationship with power, we are more likely to see the locus of power outside of ourselves, mm-hmm. and less likely, therefore, to assume as, I mean, baby boys jump out of the womb knowing they own the world. And they should, and that's what we want baby girls to do too. We haven't gotten there yet. Mm-hmm. So these are, in my view, and I'll be interested to know what the rest of the panel thinks. In my view, I don't think any of this is hardwired. I think it is all culturally learned, and therefore there are learnable, teachable skills that can enable us to move past it. You'll notice that I'll never use the word empower, because I don't believe I can empower anyone. I believe each and every one of us has the power if we have the wisdom to see it and the courage to use it. And I think I'll leave it at that, and we'll Wonderful. Move into some other things. All okay?
Right. All right. Would any of the other panelists like to speak to that?
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. I brought my little cheat sheet. Anybody who knows me knows I love a good quote, or I love a good definition, because I'm a practitioner, and I think in the world that I live in of engineers, you always need a good definition, or an equation, by the way. But yeah, and trust me, even in talent and people, you can make equations. Oh yeah. So the definition of power, I went ahead and looked up, and I'm with you wholeheartedly, Gloria. I mean, we talk about power as the ability or capacity to direct or influence the behaviors of others or a course of action, right? So I live in the world of talent. We talk about leadership all the time in the workplace. Leadership is definitely the ability to influence and inspire others in what you do and the actions. So if you even just change the language, I think power has become this word that, I don't know why, and maybe it is culturally. Obviously, I'm not from around these parts. I grew up in a small rural area in Britain, and power was not something, even when I grew up, that we talked about as a little girl quality. You're quite right. Maybe there was the B word that Jeff was using earlier on, and I've certainly heard that in my 21 years in the industry for sure, right? But talking about leadership and leading the way, leading, I think it softens it. And we need to look at our use of language and how we speak about that in the workplace. Because who doesn't want to lead? Who doesn't want to be the one that's working and influencing and inspiring others to come with them? So I'm with you, Gloria. I think and by the way, leadership is something we can all learn. It's the small steps of every day. It's the little things we can do. And by the way, even watch these ladies. I've been watching them, not to scare anybody, and I'm not even the psychologist or the background, right? You watch each other. Watch the people in the room. I'm watching you now. And based on the behaviors that you're showing, based on are you watching, are you taking notes, are you listening, are you nodding, there are things that I can learn from that. So watching other people every day is definitely a way of making sure you're looking for your own power and putting it inside of yourself, not outside. So I do think this is something that you can learn every day, and that's part of what we do in the workplace, part of what we do in talent. So I encourage you all to be practicing it even now.
Well, Sarah, thank you for that. And I'll pose this again to the panel. Do you think women are afraid of taking that power? Do we not feel like we're worthy of it, or feel a fear of taking credit for that power? I'll pose that to you.
So I will say, it's good to see everyone. Thanks for coming. I will say that the research shows that there's a gender difference in people self-nominating for power positions. So if men have 70%, 75% of the credentials, even sometimes 50% of the credentials, they'll throw their name in the hat, sometimes even 30% of the credentials. But where women are like, well, I don't have like two of the things of the 20, so I don't throw my name in the hat. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a real sort of gender difference in the way that what it means to be a woman in our society versus a man in our society. A man is independent, is assertive, takes initiative. A woman who does that is considered a bitch. Can I say that? Sorry. Right? So there's a lot of research that shows that women are kind of, is a double-edged sword, right? So if they act like a woman and they don't put themselves forward and they're kind, they're seen as a pushover. So they're never going to get ahead. They're going to be seen as a pushover. So, you know, there's a lot of self-help books and the self, you can go to the self-help section and you can learn a lot about the state of affairs. So there's one section of self-help books for women that say how to play nice. Okay. And what we know is, right, I think, I can't remember who said it, but no like self-behaving woman ever made history. Is that Eleanor Roosevelt?
Yeah.
It should be. Okay. That person. Okay, and so then you go, all right, well, I got to go ahead to a different section because I'm not going to get power if I'm nice. So you head to the power, that the section that Sheryl Sandberg writes, Lean In, and How to Act Like a Man and Have a Seat at the Table, and then you're also barraged with a lot of negativity as well, right? So it leaves you feeling like, well, maybe I should go to the section called How to Toss My Salad, okay, because it's just unclear what you should do. So I think that's a state of affairs. Women don't exactly know how to make it because you know you can't be just nice and you know you can't be really assertive. And what we need to do also is have a bigger network. So it's not just about people saying, I'm going to put myself forward. I'm going to put myself forward even if I only have 70%. But it's also about really using a gender network, a women's network. So there's a lot of talk about this thing called Queen Bee. I hate that Queen Bee. I hate the phenomenon of the Queen Bee because I don't really see that we have such a phenomenon for men, and we know that exists too. But I think it's also about really putting other women forward. And when you see other women who have engaged in that sort of Queen Bee behavior, don't call them a Queen Bee. Don't think of it like that. Think about why they might act in the ways that they act. Maybe there were no other people for them to engage with, so they had to enable to get ahead. They had to adopt strategies that may not make them the nicest or the best, okay? So I think what we need to do is not only nominate ourselves, but nominate, look for positions and look for awards and look for jobs and say, hey, Gloria, I think you'd be great at that, okay?
Well, absolutely. I think all good comments. You know, so KPMG in 2015 did a women's leadership study, and in that we surveyed and interviewed over 3,000 women, college age and adult professional working women. And the results of that were quite fascinating in that at least 60% of the women that were surveyed aspired to have very senior leadership positions. And then if you asked how many of them would put themselves forward for it, you know, there were less than 20%, which was astonishing. And I think back even in my career and in terms of sharing my story, I remember 9 years ago when the firm talked to me about making partner. And I was a new mom. I'd had a very difficult pregnancy the year before. So I wasn't quite certain whether or not I was ready to take the step to be a partner in the firm. Not that I ever doubted that I could do it, but I more questioned whether or not I wanted to take the risk at this point in my life holistically. And I think as women, really one of the bigger things for us is we don't want to take the risk. We want to know that we can do it perfect. We want to know that the time is the perfect time, it's the perfect place, and I can do it perfectly before we're sometimes willing to take the stretch and the step. And you've got to be willing to be bold and step up. And so I think, you know, looking at those survey results and really thinking about sort of probably our own careers and how we've progressed, you can really start to glean a lot about what younger women think. It's not that we doubt, we know we're powerful. We know we put our minds and our heads and our actions to it, we can get it done. But it's a matter of us thinking about how that fits holistically within life and where we are at the time and whether or not we've done enough to accomplish that assignment that gets us comfortable to take the step. And I say we've just got to take the step, whether or not we think we're ready, but we know we've got the chops in place.
I often think about and I learned from my 11-year-old son, who is quite bold, and sometimes bold with quite honestly not the right skills for the task that he's bold for. And he was a couple years ago, he's in the fifth grade, so I guess at fourth grade in his school, they let you run for student council. And some of you may have heard the story before, but he comes home and says, "Mom, I'm gonna run for student council." I go, "Great, do you know what it is?" "No." I'm like, "Okay, well, you don't know what it is. Let me tell you about it. Mom was in student council when she was growing up." So the next week, put his name in the hat to do a speech and ran for student council for his class. So got elected and ended up having the following week his first student council meeting. So he comes home from that meeting. He says, "Mom, I'm going to run for president of the student council." So I'm sitting here like, "Okay, well, first of all, like, you didn't even know what it was 3 weeks ago." And I said, "Well, are you sure you can be president? Because you just found out about this. Mm-hmm. It's kind of new and you're in the fourth grade." And he was like, "No, whatever it is, I can feel, no, surely if I'm not president, I can be vice president. No fear." Yeah. I mean, no fear. Didn't care that he didn't know what any of the capabilities or credentials were for the job, but he felt like he knew enough about himself that he could make the step. And I think I learned a lot from him just in that incident. Like, I need to put my name forward more often. But it was quite fascinating to see this young boy think, "Oh, I don't have to know kind of 1 through 10 of what the credentials were for it. I know enough about me to know that whatever it is, I can do it." So, lesson learned from an 11-year-old.
Wow. Can I jump onto that?
Absolutely.
So I, you made me remember a story that a friend of mine told about her daughter in a similar situation. Her daughter, this was in kindergarten, and the daughter and a little boy were running, each running for class president. And the girl, the daughter, her daughter, ended up, at the end of the election, it was tied. She voted for the boy. Her mother said, "Why did you do that?" And she responded, "Because I didn't want him to feel bad." Now, it's a good thing. I want to say this. I think it's very important for women not to lose that part of our socialization that makes us care about other people. I think we should not lose that. We should proactively and intentionally work on keeping those finer qualities. However, that having been said, there you go. I mean, your son was a perfect example of that difference in socialization. And the implicit bias then that, Mikki, you were talking about does things to our heads. That's a big part of why we fear taking the risks, because we think we have to be perfect. And to Sarah's point, about these being learnable, teachable skills, it's the thing is, if you think about, everybody tends to know what the pay gap data is. About what percentage is the pay gap between men and women? It's about 20%. Yeah, it's about 20%. So in tests, in experiments that have been done, and I think this is just because of all the things that what goes on in our culture does to our heads, women literally will work 20% longer than men will before they think they've earned their money. When asked to put a value on their work, they'll put a value that's approximately 20% less than they put a value on other people's work. So we ourselves, unconsciously, value ourselves less, are less of risk takers. But the good news is, we can overcome this, and that is really what the program that I've developed with Take the Lead does. So I hope you all are going to join up and take our course, because I'm telling you, it will change your life. It will give you a completely different idea about what power is, and that it's amorphous. It's what you do with it, really. It's like a hammer. You can build something with it, or you can break something apart. And as soon as we start that redefinition, all those masks fall off, and that fear of taking the risk starts to go away. So I want you all to leave feeling optimistic, because we've been telling you a lot of problem things, but I want you all to feel optimistic that there are solutions.
Well, thank you. And we've gotten through the first question. I warned you, you're going to need another sheet of paper. My brain is firing here. So I want to touch on something, Tondra, you had mentioned about your leadership journey, and you talked about considering becoming a partner and when you were having these discussions. Can you talk a little bit more about that journey and go into a little bit more detail of the decisions that you've made and maybe some of the role models that you have. Mikki had also mentioned about really promoting others and promoting other women as you see them come up. Can you talk about that piece of your career?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's funny, when I was 9 years ago going through the process about whether or not I would want to be a partner in the firm at that time. Oh, let me just say one thing. My son is president of the student council now. So yeah. He's shut. The dude, he's already got his eyes set on middle school now. He's like, oh, Mom, I'm going to be president. I was like, slow down. Anyway, so sorry, I had to mention that. But as I think about back then, and even I think about now, I've been in the managing partner role for the Houston market of KPMG for about a year and a half. And in that, I'll say that both of my biggest supporters, sponsors, and mentors were men. Mm-hmm. So I think, one, if we're going to ever really get to this gender parity, and you think about where do we want to be in the next 5 years, 10 years, we have to make some drastic changes. We talk a lot about women taking risks, but I do want to say, and within KPMG, we really focus on, as an organization, what do we need to do to be more intentional? I mean, flat out, our companies have got to be more intentional if we're going to get women into the senior ranks. Back in 2010, about 2.4% of CEOs of Fortune 500 companies were women. 2015, still less than 5%, like 4.5%. Astonishing. It's like a snail's pace of getting to any. I mean, we cannot get gender parity if we're making that slow or little progress over time. Mm-hmm. And so organizations, number one, have to become more intentional. I know we put a lot of energy into this at KPMG around how do we promote and get women into the partner ranks. And absolutely having that focus, I think, has helped us grow more partners in the firm, but it's very intentional. Mm-hmm. And it's intentional about then how do we develop the next generation of women into leaders and how do we support them, because we know that women oftentimes kind of bag themselves down and thinking about not wanting to take risk, worrying about how do I personally align my personal life with a family or just interest outside of work and having a really healthy career. Mm-hmm. Can I do it? And so I think having and being more deliberate around the types of programs that we put in place, around the targets that we put in place, quite frankly, within our companies to progress women. I think secondly, one of the big things that's kind of helped me is really just putting yourself out there to take risk and be confident in your ability and knowing that you've got some strong DNA within you to be able to be successful. And that secondly, you have a network around you to support you. And so being able to lean on and developing that network and investing in that network is critical if you're going to have any type of longevity to your career and any sort of getting into an executive position, because your network is what can help or break you if you don't have one. And I think women, sometimes we like to put our heads down and we just want to do a good job and do our best. And I know that used to be me. I mm-hmm. used to think, well, hey, if I just do a good job and do my work, it's great. I'm going to get promoted. Someone will notice it. Mm-hmm. And honestly, you need to have a network. You need to have a network because that's how you get intelligence. You need to have a network because there's 6 degrees of separation between everybody, and this person knows a person that you may not know, and they may be speaking about you, and the next thing you know, you've got an opportunity. And so having that network, companies being intentional, and then finally reaching in to pull others up. Our CEO and chairman of KPMG is a woman. I'm so proud of her, and she's a phenomenal person, Lynn Dowdy. So above just being a great leader, a person at her heart, she's fantastic. And she's like, we've got to start, we can't just move up on our own women. We've got to reach down and pull others up. So as you're moving at every level, doesn't just mean a senior executive. If you're a manager within a company, you need to be looking down and looking at women that are coming behind you and pulling them up and helping to develop them and supporting them, and also sharing with them your story, letting them know that you too have vulnerabilities, you too had doubts, but this is how you overcame them. That's the only way we're going to have this transparency. It's the only way we're going to develop people to let them know that, oh my God, okay, I don't have to have all the answers. And the only way we'll honestly get to some sort of state of gender parity over the next mm-hmm. 10 years.
Well, and one of the things I'd like to add to that, and this would sort of be a question for Sarah or for Mikki, you mentioned, in your consideration, you were thinking holistically. What does this added responsibility mean for me at work and for my new family responsibilities? Do you think more pressure has to be put on companies to think intentionally of, if I'm going to promote this person, their leadership role is maybe going to look different. How they lead, where they lead from, is it in the office? Is it at home? Is it somewhere else? Companies have to develop those plans. And Mikki, I know you've had your research where it looks at organizations and some of these barriers to entry to the leadership positions. I'd like to hear your thoughts, as well as Sarah, from your corporate experience and specifically what you do. How can companies do that?
Okay, so first of all, I loved what you said, and I second everything that all of you have said so far. There is this student who graduated from our program who just wrote a Harvard Business Review article. And in the first paragraph, she notes that there are more CEOs named David than there are women.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh.
And, dot, 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 and, David isn't even the most popular CEO name.
Oh my gosh.
Jonathan is. All right, so far we've told you about the things that you can do to get ahead. But when you look at 4.6 CEOs that are women in the Fortune 500 company, you go, wait a second, this isn't just about like, I wanna make it and I just have to have this grit. Because you know what, there are a lot of runners in the room and there are a lot of people who are willing to do the marathon and to go to the course and to lean in and to do everything right. And that's really, I think, where we also have to say, well, are we just preaching to the choir here, right? So, okay, women, keep trying, okay? And what I say is the most important people, and I mean this with great respect, maybe the men that are here in this room, okay? And so we've done research, and thank you, men, for being here. We've done research that looks at what happens when women bring up gender issues and bring up the need for change. And what the research shows is that men hear, most men, wah, 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 and they shut down. So what our research looked at is what happens if a man brings up gender issues. And what we find is that the men find that much more palatable. So this Emma Watson, who's just come under fire recently, she was started this He for She camp, or is actually speaking for the He for She campaign. And she talks about the importance of bringing men into this conversation. I cannot agree with that more and see it in our own research. When men try to recruit other men, it's successful. When women try to recruit other men, it's not as successful. In order for us to have the changes, we have got to have organizational change. This is crazy. Like, there are some places that don't have breastfeeding rooms. How many men would go into a restroom to eat their hamburger? That's not a rhetorical, that is a rhetorical question, because I don't want to know the answer, okay? I don't want to know the answer. Okay, but we're taking our babies into the bathroom to feed them? That's crazy, okay? So there are organizational structures that just absolutely have to be imposed. On the World Economic Forum, our country is what in terms of gender issues? We're 28th. We're not like sixth behind Scandinavia. Mm-hmm. Rwanda is better than we are. Okay, something is wrong. So we can sit in here and say, oh, you go, girl, you just change, you be positive. But at a certain point in time, it's like, no, we need our male allies to step up and say, this is enough. This is enough. Okay? Thank you. So I could go on about this forever, but what I will say is that men who stand up and do things for the organization make real differences. They are, and we need to keep doing what we're doing. We need to keep doing, but what we need to do is invite men. We need to invite the closest men who will listen to lead change and to lead it in the organizations throughout.
And Sarah, I know you.
Yeah, so I'm reflecting on that comment now because I was going to do a little bit of the rah-rah, we can do it. Now, I'm not so sure I might balance it if that's okay. Yeah. Because I was going to say, one of the things, that the words that I think of, and I think of my 21-year career, mother of two, many challenges in my family and life, and balancing that, in inverted commas, balancing it with work, is I do still think of resilience and relentlessness. And that was the words that was brought up earlier today. And I do think that comes with passion and belief. And I think when I look at my off-ramps, on-ramps, I think I had at least three, maybe four in my career. And when I think about the relationships that I built on the off-ramp to make sure that I could, you're quite right. I was intentional that it wasn't just the women in the industry and the businesses I worked in. I made sure not only had I added value before I left, I made sure not only did people know that, but I made sure that there was men in that conversation too, because I just knew from the numbers in the oil and gas industry, you got to play the numbers, right? I mean, who are the people I'm going to be having the conversations with to come back into the business? So I definitely think that that comes a part of it. And I think my drive and relentlessness and passion did come from role models, did come from examples, both men and women, by the way. And then later on in my career, it definitely came from my children. I love that everybody's brought that up so far. I have a wonderful 11-year-old little girl, though she doesn't like me calling her a little girl anymore, my little woman. I have a 15-year-old son who've both had challenges of their own. And I think my power, and I'm British, it's difficult for me to say. It's like a bit like an AA meeting, right? My power came from, I have power. I'm British and I have power. If I can say it, ladies, if I can say it, you all can, okay? Seriously, my stiff upper lip Brit, I mean, they came from my children. I reckon I was 38 the day that I truly knew my own power. And it came from a combination of two things. It came from my son's diagnosis with Asperger's when he was 5 and a half. And knowing that I could learn to lead him through change. I could learn to show him what influence truly looked like. And I could get him to accept who he was and the strengths that he had. And by the way, now he's a first year at Strake and doing absolutely fabulously academically. And I'm so proud of him. He's going to get upset that I mentioned him because he wants to watch it later. But seriously, it comes from that. And then my daughter had a near-life death experience when she was 6. And I look at the power that she has every day and the wisdom she shares with her friends and the way she talks about the value that she brings to the world, knowing what she knows. I have no qualms walking into the workplace with, I can't talk about the stats of the people I work with, but they don't look like me. They're a little older and they're mostly on the male side. But I have no problem walking in there and telling them the truth. I love the phrase that was used earlier today, and I'm going to put it on my tag now instead of connector, achiever, practitioner. I think I'm going to go with CTO. I am the chief tension officer.
Yes.
Whether you call it a disruptor, whether you call it, you know, a chief tension officer, what I do in the company I work in is say the difficult things. And by the way, they're not difficult because nobody knows them. Mm-hmm. They're difficult because nobody says them out loud. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, with my son and my daughter, that's all I've taught them to do over the last 11 and 15 years is to say it out loud. So ladies, gents in the room, all I can say is, yeah, I am a bit of a rah-rah, I'm sorry, but I speak with passion, I speak with practical, I do think we can do this. I do think, I'll go one last thing, it's not even about parity to me, it's not even about equality. When I start to hear that whether that's we as women, let's start there, but maybe what if it's not about being equal? Maybe what if it's about being better? What if it's about knowing that the value that we can bring to our organizations, especially this industry, with the change it's going through in the next couple of years and the war on talent, what if we helped each other up so much that those numbers change drastically in the next 5 years? What if? And that's possible. Yeah, okay.
I like that.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let's do that. I feel like I want to say something that every single person here can do. Every one of us here has the ability to do this. And by the way, since everybody has brought up parenthood, and I have a lot of kids, and my husband and I have 6 between us, so and lots of grandkids, I actually recently wrote an article that was entitled "Put Parenthood on Your Resume," because I think we need to start a whole. What teaches you more, right? What teaches you more? Nothing teaches you more. But that having been said. I there's one thing that each and every one of us can do, and if everybody in this room did this once a month, once a year, it would start to truly change systems, and it would start to truly change the ratio. And it's, and I will tell you what this, somebody did this for me, and it was unbeknownst to me until many years later. Her name was Mildred. She was my first boss. My first job was teaching at Head Start. And she kept asking me to take on projects that I never would have thought I was qualified for. And she kept pushing me to do these things. After I left that role, I subsequently, a few months later, heard that she was in the hospital with terminal cancer. So I went to visit her. And as I left, Mildred handed me an envelope. I didn't open it until I got home. When I opened the envelope, what I found was she had written a reference for me. She had written a reference letter for me. I hadn't asked her to do it. She was ill, and she knew what her future held. She had taken the time to write a reference letter for me. Since she had been my only boss, when I went to look for my next position, that was the only reference that I had. My next position was to become the CEO of what was then a small nonprofit, and it led me to ultimately become the CEO of a very large national organization. So she changed my life with that. Each one of us has the capacity to do one thing for another woman, or if you're a man, to do one thing for a woman that helps that other person move up in her career and in her life. So can we all do that? Yes. We can all do that.
Absolutely. Thank you. We're going to start to take audience questions now.
No. Let me just do that. Perfect. Ah, there we go. How about? So the question online is, is there any research on whether men who champion gender equality pay a penalty? Do they pay a penalty, or are they rewarded for that behavior?
Well, in the research we did, and it was 5 studies, and it hasn't been published yet, but it hopefully will be soon, what we see is the men like those men more. So they're more willing to purchase things from them than they are women. So I think the question might be, but how do they feel about those men versus potentially other men? And that we haven't done yet. So I do think that there's, so we know that relative to women, they very much like the men better and the things that the men have to say and the messages for women. Clearly, if you think about organizations, there are some men who, you know, we're thinking about stereotypes. So there are some men who might be seen as, oh, that's a soft man, or that man is gay, and so they may be denigrated in some ways. So I think, you know, I say every man should champion, but I do think you want to get out a group of men who are not only, we call them feminists or man champions. You can call them whatever you want, okay? But you know who they are in your organization, and what you ideally want them to be is just like everything from every group and every sort of sphere of your organization, so that it's not, oh, that one person who does it, but it's a normative, it's a cultural organizational thing. So you have people at the top ideally championing, you have people at the mid, you have people at the lowest levels, and then you have people who cut across every diversity queue. And what we know is that we can say from looking at race too, when the people who have the higher status champion the causes of the lower status, people of the higher status are more likely to listen. So whether they're liked more, you know what? I don't even care.
Well, thank you. And as I said, we can go on and on. I think we're running out of time here. So I want to ask the panelists, will you be around the rest of the day? That if the audience would like to say hello and ask you questions, they can. Okay, great. All right. Well, thank you all, and thank you.
Wonderful discussion. I want to add that after the lunch break, there is going to be a speaker who is going to talk more about the role of men as allies. Josh Levs is going to be part of that conversation. So for those of you who particularly want to hear more on that, it's your lucky day.